Hello, everyone, and welcome to this Open Day session at the Creative Computing Institute. My name is Georgina Capdevila, and I'm the Creative Learning Producer at CCI. And today, we are here to talk about our Masters of Research, or MRes, in Creative Computing. And we've got with us Professor Mick Grissom, Dr. Rebecca Fibring, and Kenneth Lim, who's a current student at the MRes in Creative Computing. And before we start, just a few notes are important to mention. As you may already know, this Open Day session is complementary to the one that we run in December 2020. So if you haven't done it yet, I would strongly encourage you to watch the recording of the past information session, which is available on our YouTube channel under the Open Day playlist. So let's get this started. So we all have plenty of questions, right? That's part of our human nature, isn't it? So the aim of today's event is to make sure that all the questions and doubts that arise in the process of applying to this particular course, the MRes and Creative Computing, are answered from a variety of perspectives. In order to do that, we've put together a list of the most frequently asked questions about this course. And as we go along, we'll see the different questions appearing in a banner at the bottom of the screen. However, this is an open and safe space for all of you to have a say as well. So don't hesitate to ask us anything that you would like us to maybe clarify, something that hasn't been covered during the session. Feel free to post it on the chat, and we'll do our best to answer these queries as well. In terms of accessibility, we are live streaming on YouTube today, so we won't have live captions available during the session. But please note that this session will be captioned afterwards, and a recording will be uploaded on our YouTube channel, so you can rewatch if you need to catch any details that maybe you missed or anything that you would like to go through. So I think that's all from me now. So without further ado, I would like now invite me, Rebecca, and Kenneth to just say hi, and yeah, we'll get started with the questions after that.
Thanks very much, Georgina. And hi, everyone. Welcome to this Open Day session. My name is Professor Mick Grierson, and I'm Research Leader at Creative Computing Institute at UAL. And it's a pleasure to be here. Rebecca, would you like to introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Rebecca Fibring. I'm a reader at CCI. I've been working at CCI for a couple years now, but working with master's and PhD students, supervising research for over a decade now. So great to be here. Looking forward to meeting many of you.
Hey, everyone. I'm Kenneth, and I'm one of the students at the MRes Creative Computing here at CCI. And I'm about halfway through the course right now. So I'm happy to answer any questions like from a student perspective.
Beautiful. Thanks, everyone, for joining us today. It's a pleasure to be here in this virtual space. So we're gonna start with the first question, which says, what exactly is an MRes? So okay. I believe that Mick has the answer to that. So feel free to share.
So yeah, what's an MRes and why would you do one? Well, an MRes is a master's, but it's different to a taught master's. So you may have heard, you may have thought about taking an MA or an MSc, an MA being a master's in the arts, an MSc being a master's in sciences. We have at UAL, we have MAs and MSCs you can take. An MRes is something else. An MRes is a master's of research, and it's by research. So in that sense, it's not a taught master's program in that sense. It's more about enhancing and developing your skills as a researcher. So it's an opportunity to learn the tools and expertise required to engage in academic research in a particular field. And the CCI MRes is focused on creative computing as a field. So that's quite a broad field, and it's quite hard to describe. For us, I think it's getting easier to describe because we do it all the time. One way to think of creative computing is just as the confluence of creative arts and industries, applications of computer science. But that's quite a broad area. There's a lot there. And so we introduce you to a range of different areas and to prepare you for undertaking further research, including potentially a PhD in your chosen area of study. So that's basically what the MRes is. It's not a PhD. It's a means to understand how to prepare yourself to undertake further research later, including possibly an MPhil or PhD. So that's basically what the MRes is. I mean, are there any questions about that? I've got plenty more I can say, and I could move on and talk about the next frequently asked question, if that's a good move, Georgina. Shall I do
that? Thank you, Mick. That already covered the second question, which was, will the MRes help me to prepare for a research career? So that's like a definite yes.
That's what it's for. That's exactly what it's for. And I think it's important to think about what you would learn, because that helps to kind of define what the process is really going to do for you. And it's about defining your approach. I think a lot of people, when they think, you know what, I'd like to do research, I'd like to get an MRes, I'd like to do more study and really think deeply about things in an academic context. And that's super exciting. But it's also sometimes not as easy as it sounds. And there are some skills that you can learn to do that. But in a way, experience is really important. And how do you know where to start? What we're trying to do is help provide you with that support so you can define your approach better. You can understand how to make clear what it is you're doing. So that's about many things. It's about understanding and furthering your knowledge in a particular field. So it might be that you're really interested in music technology and you want to know what kinds of research you could do in that area. It might be that you're really interested in an area of arts practice, sculpture, maybe interactive sculpture or architecture, or journalism or filmmaking. And you want to apply computing in that realm in a way which other people haven't done before, but you're not quite sure what has been done. So understanding and furthering your knowledge in that field is a place to start. And MRes is a good way to do that. Also, focusing your research ambitions on an area of interest, right? So it may be that you want to do three or four different things and you might feel really excited about all of them. But that's not going to work in a research career necessarily. I mean, it might do, but often it's simpler to try to narrow your field so that you can focus in on something which you know you're really passionate about. And that allows you to discover and explore the edge. A friend of mine is a comic artist, and he was working with us to try and define what research is. And we spoke about it for a while, and I said to him, you know, in a way, it's like approaching the edge of a cliff or maybe the edge of a forest. And you can't really see what's in there, and you know you have to enter, and you know not many people go in. But it's your job to find that edge, to find the edge of that forest, and then to step in. And I think understanding where it is and how to get to it, and then knowing what to do once you're in there, that's what the MRes is trying to prepare you for. So part of this is understanding and using the right research methods and approaches relevant for the problems that you're discovering or that you want to discover. And the other part of this is understanding how to map that, yeah, how to articulate and speak about what you found, to make it available for other people in a way that supports you and also them to continue those ideas. So that's what you will learn. There's a process, there's a method, and there are skills and experiences that you can gain from an MRes that make these kinds of tasks easier to do. And also, you're in a community of people around you who are doing that all the time to help you, to help that whole process rub off. So you can enter that forest and map it out and come out and say, hey, everyone, look at these paths I found. So that's what the MRes is about. It's about teaching you how to do that. Does that make sense?
That's a beautiful metaphor. Thanks, Mick. Excellent. Amazing. So the next one that we have, probably we've already kind of covered that one, but is, should I apply for a PhD or do an MRes instead? I believe that's like a very frequent question.
It is. And I think that often people come and they say they want to learn a PhD. They want to do a PhD because a PhD is a super exciting thing, you know. The most important thing about a PhD for people is the idea that you're making a contribution to knowledge. Everybody thinks, and many, many people think that's super exciting. And it is very, very exciting. But it's also very, very hard, you know. And sometimes, like I say, you don't really have, you think you know you can do it and you believe that you can do it. Or maybe you're concerned that you can't, but other people think you can, right? And both of those feelings, they're positions, I think many researchers have, I found myself feeling both those things, right? So what you need to, one skill that you need before you can undertake a PhD is to learn how to write an effective PhD proposal. And that's something which is very hard to know how to do if you've never done it before. But it's essential. You can't begin a PhD until you can do that. If you feel that you can already write an effective proposal and that people are telling you your proposal for your PhD is really good, like experts are saying that, maybe you don't need to do an MRes. But if you're sending a PhD proposal out and you're not getting the response that you might want, maybe there are things, maybe you might consider doing an MRes, because it will increase your chances of making a successful PhD application, writing a better, more focused, more thorough proposal. And it'll help you develop an awareness of the differences between, for example, what you might think of as personal research, things that where you're making a personal discovery, but also the research that's valuable to the rest of the world as well. It may be that the things you're exploring, they're important for you. How can you make those important for others? That's not always as easy as it sounds. And that's what you need to do to make a genuine contribution to knowledge, you know, with the emphasis being on the knowledge in the world. So, yeah, that's what the MRes helps you to do. And so if you feel you can already do that, PhD is right for you. But if you're, even if you're confident you've done that and you're not quite getting the response you want from your proposal, it might be that an MRes is the right choice. So yeah, that's what I would say in answer to that question.
Great, thanks, Meek. I was just thinking now, maybe it would be great to hear from you, Kenneth. What were your motivations to be part of these MRes? Where did you come from? What were you interested in that you're like further exploring during the course this year?
Yeah, so kind of for me, I've already did a kind of practice-based MA, MA Information Experience Design at the RCA. And the thing about the MRes is that, well, I guess if it's something that, well, I guess for me at least, the reason why I'm thinking about an MRes is that, well, I'm not sure whether I want to do a PhD or not. And an MRes is a perfect opportunity for me to at least have a try at kind of academic research and kind of different research methods in creative computing and things like that. And to really try it out in a really rigorous fashion. And then hopefully by the end of this, or maybe sometime before that, I'll have figured out, okay, whether the PhD is a right decision for me, or maybe I would kind of like to go into industry first before thinking about that and things like that. So that's kind of where I come from.
Great, thanks, Kenneth. That's super useful to hear. Beautiful. So we'll move to the next question, which is, what is the difference between creative computing at CCI and elsewhere? What makes MRes Creative Computing at UAL CCI so unique?
So, hey, Rebecca, I would love to hear you answer this question.
Sure. I mean, at the moment, I think it's exciting the number of places where you could go to do research in creative computing. It's a growing number. When I was looking for master's programs, it was much smaller than it is now, but it is still, you know, a relatively small field. And each university is, you know, not only trying to, you know, to do the best thing for their students, but really innovating in imagining, okay, what is it that the creative computing researchers of, you know, the next decade are going to need in their skill set? What is it, you know, what is even the scope of possible PhDs? Because this is, you know, in many ways, a field that is still crystallizing. It's a field with many different voices from many different disciplines all active in it at once. So it's a very vibrant place to be. And because of that, each different university has, I think, very different takes on, you know, how they support students, the types of research communities that they have, what kinds of disciplines are represented, what kinds of research methods tend to be in the set of expertise of people who might be your supervisors, and so on. You know, personally, I came to CCI about 2 years ago because I was really excited by the vision that people here had about how to make this a really inclusive, vibrant, open place where people could come in with mixtures of really crazy off-the-wall ideas and, you know, really solid proven research methods or you know, proven research track records. And there's a space for all of that. And when you get that in the same space and mix it up, I think really fun things happen. You know, I think at CCI, research methods has been mentioned a few times, you know, by Mick and by Kenneth. For me, one of the most important things I see for people considering doing a PhD is that the set of research methods that you could apply in creative computing is actually quite enormous. It's not like going and doing a PhD in art history or going and doing a PhD in computer science, especially, you know, a field like machine learning research or systems research, right? There's not a core small, well-understood set of research methods in creative computing. Instead, we use research methods from computer science, from human-computer interaction, from design. We use qualitative and quantitative methods. We do hard statistics. We build software and hardware systems and throw them out into the world. We study people. And we also, you know, have space for people's artistic practice, doing practice-driven research methods. And so I think it can be really daunting for someone who, you know, almost everybody comes from an undergraduate degree in just one of these domains, and they've seen one slice of it if they've been exposed to much research at all. And in fact, it can be really difficult to then look and say, well, I would really like to do interdisciplinary research at the intersections of computing and some other domain. One of the biggest challenges, I would say, is not just about saying, well, what do I think is interesting as a researcher, but practically, how do I go about that? What kinds of methods do I want in my toolkit? You know, one of the things I'm really proud of here is that, you know, we're a space where people who are, you know, full-time academics at CCR are using a lot of these, you know, different approaches and different methods. We are, you know, passing that on to our students in our teaching and in the MRes program itself. That's an explicit goal that we have for students, is to help them get familiar with that landscape, help them learn to navigate it. We're not going to tell them, oh, well, if you know, want to do research in this field, here's the standard methods book, go read it. But rather to say, well, this is the really messy current landscape we're in, and there's not a right decision, but part of you deciding what your PhD might look like is actually charting a path through that space yourself. So I think that that's one of the most important outcomes of an MRes, and it's something that we're thinking about a lot here.
Thanks, that's brilliant.
Thank you, Rebecca. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, you know, I think the social mission really helps to focus the work that we do and maintain our values. And I think that's why a lot of people feel that CCI is a place for where they can land and their values will be respected and understood and engaged with, and in a way which is reasonably, you know, is reasonably considered, correctly considered, if you see what I mean, as a very, very important part of the research, you know?
Yeah, I would agree with that as well, and chip in and say, that's another reason that I came to CCI. It's, you know, it's not like we're doing academic research and then, you know, on the side engaging with London school kids in our local neighborhood, or on the side, you know, inviting people in to do workshops on social activism and art. Like, it's part of the research that people who are here are doing. It's part of our teaching. It's part of the way we see creative computing's position in the larger world.
Precisely. Absolutely. That's absolutely it.
Beautiful. Thanks both. Yeah, it feels relevant to talk about what is the CCI social mission here, which is another question that we got a lot as well.
Yeah. Well, that's, our social mission is deep and rich, and it's not something we can be glib about. But I think that, you know, you can read about it on our website. But fundamentally, we're interested in, for example, kinds of research which bring democratic and open and equal, prioritizing equal equalities and access and the rights and behaviors of humans in the realm of computing as part of a kind of creative vision as well. I mean, I think that's kind of the way that we see, for example, I think that's natural for a creative industries or creative arts focused center, because so much of what goes on in the creative industries is focused on those issues about voices, by diverse voices and the representation of people, particularly potentially marginalized people. The questions, you know, we're often asked is, you know, how does that really impact on research? Well, it impacts centrally on all research, because the ethical issues around, let's take AI, for example. There's quite a lot of research that's happened in AI, but it focuses on areas which have quite negative legal and ethical consequences. We don't want to do those things. You know, we want to do very different things. So, and I've said this a number of times, in computing generally, there's often a focus on military applications, finance applications, behavioral modification or management. And those have significant negative ethical and cultural and social outcomes. And I think that that research really is not of great benefit to people, and people aren't at the center of that research. Not really. I think for us, our social mission puts people right at the center. People, their values, representations, and their beliefs, their freedoms, at the center of the project. And that's, you know, I mean, there's a lot more I could say, but that's, you know, I'm trying to encompass an approach which is very different. We don't see ourselves allied to you know, military, finance, other areas that are often considered allies of computer science. For us, that's not, they're not our allies.
Thank you, Mick.
I hope that's clear.
Yeah, it is clear. Yeah, it feels relevant as well to go to the next question, which is, what is the actual research mission at CCI and what are the key research themes?
Great. So I'll be as quick as I can. So we have three research themes: creativity, machine learning and AI, human-computer interaction, and platforms, big data, and digital citizenship. The first one, creativity, machine learning and AI, pursues new knowledge in how machine learning and artificial intelligence can accelerate and transform creative arts in the 21st century. So really, again, that includes making things, making technologies that artists might want to use, seeing how artists use technologies and using that as a way to understand how to transform those technologies. And there being a mutually beneficial relationship. And sometimes it's just one researcher doing both at the same time, right? And so, but there are lots of other things. How can we use machine learning and AI to support people in society generally, people with disabilities, improving access? Wouldn't it be great if everyone could be a data scientist, you know? And wouldn't it be great if people with disabilities and learning cognitive disabilities, for example, could do their own data science? And so we're not just asking those questions, we're actively pursuing trying to understand what happens when you do those things. At the same time, a lot of our students are artists and they produce art using AI right at the cutting edge of what is possible. And they are making improvements to cutting edge AI and machine learning, building systems that other people just aren't building because they're not thinking about the creative applications. We have a number of grants in that area. We have a lot of students working in that field, including Angus Main, who's working with Google, on a project looking at how we design AI systems that are used to support design. Terence Broad, who is focused really on arts practice, but I would say subverting existing large multi-million pound models produced by large companies like Google, subverting them for creative purposes, and Memo Acton, and lots of others, actually, lots of other great students. The second theme is human-computer interaction, and this is, in a way, a theme doesn't do this justice. This is a massive area of research, which is a hugely important part of what we do. We're in a unique position to impact on HCI research globally. I feel, Rebecca, you should really talk about this if you can.
Sure. So, you know, I would agree with Mick. This isn't just a single theme, in that, you know, well, there's some researchers at CCI who are HCI researchers and other people who aren't. I would say, in some sense, because of this social mission and because of the focus on people first and designing creative technologies for people, as opposed to, you know, just algorithms that mimic human creative practice and don't do anything else, for instance. You know, everybody here is engaged with thinking about how technology can benefit people, whether that's professional creators, whether that's learners, whether that's members of the broader public. People are thinking about how to effectively link computational techniques, algorithms, hardware, how to link technology with people in order to add value, in order to enable people to do totally new things, in order to enable people to work more effectively in order to support new types of relationships between people and so on. So that is really cross-cutting across pretty much everything happening here. And like the broad field of human-computer interaction itself, again, there are people approaching these questions from very computer science standpoints and looking at algorithmic mechanisms to enable human interaction where it hasn't been possible before. There are people looking at this from design. There are people working on this as individual practicing artists who are reflecting on the tools that they're using and maybe building new types of tools and interactive systems and artworks themselves and informing the larger community there.
That's brilliant. Yeah. And I think it's right, echoing what you said earlier about the importance of methodologies. Methodologies associated with HCI, I think, are central to quite a lot of work that we do. And so it's more, it is more than just a theme, but it is very important. And we highlight it in the same way we highlight these other areas that we're talking about. Finally, our third theme is platforms, big data, and digital citizenship. And this is really about as everybody now knows, has been made very clear, contemporary digital systems and online services and social platforms are everywhere, and they particularly post-pandemic define so much of about what we do, how we behave, how we are defined socially, how we interact, and understanding them, considering how they impact human behavior, how they constrain and also emancipate. It's becoming central to the economy, but it has ethical and social implications that really can't be ignored. Lots of our work has explored this theme from an accessibility and democratization standpoint. We want to do a lot more. We've had some large grants in this area, but we're also bringing on new staff to lead in these fields, particularly in the area of social data science. And I think it's a growth area for us. So they're our main themes. And that's kind of, that gives you a good overview of how the work you might be thinking of doing would fit under our umbrellas.
Thanks for that, Mick, which leads us to the following question, which is what relevant projects have been developed by researchers at CCI, which is the slide that you have ready for us.
Oh yeah, that's it. So I'm gonna be reasonably brief about this. There's quite a lot going on. One thing which we've been doing is the Mimic Project, and that is a website, mimicproject.com, which is designed to support artists to allow them to give them access, easier access online to systems that allow them to make music and art with machine intelligence. Now, this isn't about just one form of machine intelligence. It's about other kinds. You may have seen people who are doing things with generative systems and generative adversarial networks, things like that. We do a lot of that work. We don't tend to do that work online as much because the issues, we're obviously moving towards that. But this project, although it incorporates some of that work, it's also very much focused on interaction and also encouraging people and trying to support people to build tools who are already programming a little bit. The platform is actually a programming platform in many, many ways. You don't need to have a lot of tools to be able to use it, but it's been quite successful, and we've used it to support some of the students who are both inside CCI and also on our massive open online courses as a way to, deliver an enhanced learning. And so you can see here, it's like an IDE. There are, I think for us, what's unique and special about this is that it contains approaches, philosophies and ideas wrapped together in kind of code libraries to try to encourage use, reuse, sharing, which are a bit different to those other ones that are available. And when we started this project, there weren't really any other platforms like it. Of course, now there's quite a lot, but we still like this one. Wekinator is another project which is originated and developed by staff at CCI, namely Rebecca Fiebrink. Rebecca, please tell us about Wekinator.
Yeah, so Wekinator has been around a long time now. Originally I started making it in 2008. The current version is from about 2015. It's had over 40,000 downloads since then. It's used in creative projects by professional creators and students around the world, everything from gesturally controlled new musical instruments to interactive art projects where gestures of a performer or movements of audience members in a space or real-time sound influence things like robots or light or interactive animations. People have used it in multimedia operas. People have used it in social activism. People have used it to create really silly things that get written up in the Daily Mail. it's some free software that, you know, I still teach with today, but it also, the ideas about how to make machine learning accessible to creative practitioners that are embedded in Wekinator have now made it into a bunch of other tools. So for instance, you know, Mick mentioned Mimic. There are also tools like Google's Teachable Machine, which you might have seen, which is partly based on Wekinator. So it's an example of, you know, again, the kind of work that we often really like to do at CCI, where we're, you know, we're working with professional creators or students or community members to make technology that makes somebody's life easier, that allows them to do something that they couldn't do before. But then that also becomes not just a, you know, let's develop some tech together project, but it becomes a research project where we really learn more about the consequences for new kinds of technology in creative practice and daily life. So this has really influenced many other projects at CCI.
Brilliant, thank you. And so some students at CCI have also developed software which has been used by quite a lot of people, and also artworks which have been seen and cited. One of our PhD students, Memo Acton, we've worked with him a lot, and he just recently graduated in January. His work was cited by NVIDIA in a keynote, I believe, in the 2019 NeurIPS conference, he's exploring generative systems, live interactive generative AI systems. And his work's really fantastic. You might want to check it out. Terence Broad recently, he's another one of our students who is in our kind of surrounding research culture. He has done a number of interesting things, including he made a version of Blade Runner, which was generated by an artificial neural network in about 2016, which created a lot of interest. It was the first time someone had created a whole video using this technique. And it was bought by a number of museums and is considered an artwork in its own right now. He's recently published work in a field called network bending, which is, I think I mentioned before, is about subverting existing models by reprogramming them on the fly to get them to do things they're not supposed to do. In addition, we have a project called Heart and Soul at the Hub, which this phase one is completed and we've now started phase two. Phase one was funded by the Wellcome Trust, who are a large organization focusing on medical health and well-being. And we occupied their hub for 2 years. Well, their hub is like a part of their building. We had a large area up there, which we modified together. I was a collaboration with Heart and Soul, who are a large learning disabled arts charity run by people and founded by people with learning disabilities who are also musicians and artists based in Deptford. And I've been working with them for best part of 10 years. And we have created, we're now in phase two. What we've been working on is, you know, building systems that support the perspectives and views and values of people and communities with learning disabilities. And now we're in a kind of phase two where we've been funded by the Health Foundation to work with NHS nurses and occupational therapists and groups of other people to introduce new methods, new ways of working with the communities that they support. And this is Pino. Pino is one of the founders of Heart and Soul. And yeah, he's very much the boss of this project and this new project we have with the Health Foundation. It's really about, it's about his enthusiasm, his passion. He has an OBE for his work and commitment to learning disabled communities in the UK, and he's quite an astonishing individual. And there's more I could say about that, but we also have the 4i project, which is a project that Rebecca is involved in. Rebecca, would you like to talk about that?
Sure. This is a collaboration with academics at a few other institutions, as well as a wide variety of interactive artists and game designers. We're building on some past research, including Wekinator, which we just mentioned, building new tools for VR creators to use machine learning in their work. And so this is really targeting making it easier to make embodied interactions for dance, for interactive art, for indie games. And we've got a tool that you can download in Unity right now called InteractML. We've got an Unreal version coming out soon. And like the Wekinator project that I mentioned, this really pairs technology development with really close collaboration with a diverse set of creators trying to understand how we can make technology more usable and also understand the creative consequences for enabling people to do new things.
Fantastic. That's a great project. And there's an epic mega grant attached to that, or which leads on from that work, isn't there? Is that right?
There is, yep.
And so that's taking these ideas and putting it in Unreal. So yep. Creating an Unreal plugin which does the same thing, or largely similar things. And that's a tremendously exciting project, funded by Epic Games. Project Tokyo, that's one of your projects too, isn't it, Rebecca?
Yep, this is a collaboration with people at Microsoft Research and a few other universities, including Oxford and University of Edinburgh. And this is one of these projects that's, you know, it's not explicitly focused on creative work, but nonetheless intersects with some of the really important questions at the heart of our social mission at CCI. I would say that broadly, this is a human-computer interaction project done in partnership with people with visual impairments and blindness, and exploring ways that computer vision systems can help people navigate social interactions. So this is a really large collaborative project. I have a PhD student on this project who's exploring some really interesting questions around how to effectively pair people and AI systems, especially when people aren't professional computer scientists. Here, there are people who have, you know, are blind or visually impaired, and they want to live their lives and they want to work efficiently and they want more information that they don't currently have access to. What are the roles AI can play there? But even more importantly, I think the work that we're focused on is how do you enable people to use these systems effectively, to customize them, to understand them, and then to take them and do things that researchers like us didn't foresee.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. Quickly, that we also have a project which is run by Dr. Vali Laliotti, who is a program director here at CCI. Hearts Professional, it's a collaboration with the Royal College of Music and Imperial College, and it's to do with providing an environment to allow musicians to continue to rehearse together in virtual worlds where they can hear the acoustics of the space that they're working in or practicing or supposed to be in and performing in. And it's been funded by the Arts and Humanities Research Council as part of the COVID-19 emergency funding. This is a slide to remind me to talk about our Accessible Interfaces course and also, well, actually to talk about our Future Learn program. We launched a Future Learn program last May, and within 6 months, we'd had 60,000 people on it. The reason I mention this is a lot of the, if you're interested in understanding the kinds of things that you, the skills that you might want to develop or what kind of application areas might be of interest to you, that you might learn or explore as part of the MRes, some of these courses might help you. There are four different ones, one on independent games development, one on feminist conversational interfaces, one on accessible interfaces, and one on creative machine learning. And there are 2 week introductions and then a 4 week course, and they are currently still free. So they're part of the government's, UK government skills toolkit, which is surprising. We're actually very pleased that that's happened. They're now part of a set of courses which the government has nominated as to represent the sorts of skills which they want to promote and encourage people to gain. Although I'm not sure this robot's going to help anybody. Anyway, that's kind of it. There's a whole bunch of other stuff. There's some work that we did with Massive Attack, where we remixed one of their records using a long short-term memory network. That's on tour for 5 years as part of the AI More Than Human exhibition put together by Tokyo Science Museum and the Barbican. Recently, that work was highlighted by the HRC, who are the Arts and Humanities Research Council. Actually, that's wrong. It's the United Kingdom's Research and Innovation, sorry, who cited it in one of their most recent reports on AI. So a lot of that work has been highlighted and is seen as nationally and internationally world leading. So there's a whole range of work there, including by our students and by staff. And I think that that's probably much more than you need to know. So like we've got some students who are doing exciting work, both in practice, also in thinking about, critically about how we explore these our research themes, but also we're running projects that I think I feel confident saying at the very highest level in creative computing. So I hope that's helpful.
It really is, Mick. Thanks a lot. Well, thanks both, Mick and Rebecca, for showing this inspiring and insightful presentation, because it really gives a clear idea of all the like endless paths that could open up for a current research student at CCI. And it's truly, truly inspiring to see that. Great. Beautiful. Before we jump onto the more practical, frequently asked questions, there's a great question from Marsha, who pasted on the chat. I'm just going to make it visible for everyone. Okay, so Marcia says, thanks for this great presentation, and it's great to be talking about methods. Is there a taught methods course? Can you explain what this entails?
Yes. So there is a taught methods course program, and it is delivered as part of the MRes, and it's taught by a range of staff at the Institute, all of whom are active researchers. It also incorporates work by some of our PhD students. But yes, so it talks about a range of different methods for different types of research, exactly as Rebecca said earlier. So mixed methods approaches, qualitative research, quantitative research, data science approaches.
Design-led approaches.
Yeah, design-led approaches, design thinking, workshop-based work. And
practice-based
work, iterative prototyping. So we try to go through as many different approaches as we can think of that we know are relevant to the research our students are undertaking. That's a series of weekly lectures, and it's an essential part of the program.
And I should also mention that ethics is part of the taught provision, yes, as well. It's not just one lecture here at the end. It's really woven through discussion of methods, discussion of the publishing culture in academia, ethics as it relates to a lot of the practical things that people encounter as PhD students and young researchers, and things that come up that are, the ethical issues on top of everyone's minds right now in AI and creative technology and so on.
Yeah, and so we have as part of the methods course, there are separate ethics lectures just on AI. And just on working with people with disabilities, so it's very much an active thing. Also, I should say that for our PhD program, we require a statement, an ethics statement, at the point of proposal, and we require that for all of our researchers. And we are very keen to ensure people understand that issues such as data privacy, issues such as the potential impact of what you do. These aren't small things that you just have to do to satisfy a lawyer somewhere. These are things that are absolutely critical and crucial for us, that we care deeply about, that we want you to care about. So, yeah. Okay, are there any other questions?
Yeah, so now my suggestion is to just put ourselves in the shoes of someone who wants to be part of this MRes. Like, what do they need to know to apply? What sort of requirements are we asking them to present at some level? For example, one question would be, what are the technical requirements to apply? Do I need a portfolio to apply? How does the application process work?
So you can apply online via the usual UAL channels. You don't really need a portfolio as such. A traditional portfolio isn't required. However, it's always good to have examples of what you can already do. It's always good to incorporate as much information about your background, skills, and experience as you can. And if you have a portfolio, then it would be great to see. Or if you've built something, that would be good to see. Or if there is an academic paper that you've published perhaps as part of another master's, that would also be great to see. I think the additional materials are helpful because they give us a lot of information about the kinds of person, the kind of research you want to do, and the kind of person you are, and where you are in your journey. But yeah, a typical portfolio, that's not really what, I don't think we're really looking for something that, you know, that you, if you were applying for a master's in fine art, for example, that we wouldn't be looking for something specific like that. I think what we want is something to support your application with respect to the kinds of work you want to do.
Thank you, Meek. I thought as well it would be worth asking Kenneth about your experience as well, applying, what sort of project did you present? How was it for you to get into the course?
Yeah, I know Meek just mentioned like portfolio is not the important part, but my application do include a portfolio because, well, I come from a practice-based degree, so I do have a portfolio. But kind of at the same time, in my application, I think like one of them is kind of asking kind of motivational statements about like why I want to do the MRes and why do I want to do research in general, academic research in general. And so that kind of really did make me think about, okay, why do I want to get into academic research? What is the value of research to me? Why do I want to do it as a practice? So it is something that is something that I'm not necessarily I've considered before, but as part of the application process, it really does help put things into kind of more concrete terms so it really does help.
Thank you, Kenneth. Amazing. We have another question from Marcia. I'm just going to show it on the screen. Marcia says, what's your relationship with UAL's doctoral culture? Who would like to take on this one?
Oh, that's a great question. So there are two things I would say. The first one is, if you're on the MRes, then you are less likely to have as much contact with the rest of UAL's doctoral culture than if you're on the PhD program, MPhil PhD program. But that doesn't mean that it's completely cut off from you. And to be really specific, UAL has an introductory series of lectures for MPhil PhD students called the Renewal Program. You wouldn't necessarily be part of that, but that doesn't mean you can't turn up. And it doesn't mean that you can't turn up to all the other events. The great thing about UAL is it has really rich, active colleges where there's loads of things happening all the time. So we contributed, and our students from our master's programs and our PhD programs and everywhere in between contributed to some of the festivals that recently were on at St. Martin's, for example, just back in January. And those things are happening quite often. There's a lot of integration across the cohorts anyway. Having said all of that, at CCI, we have a postgraduate research group where all researchers are welcome. And that includes MPhil students, PhD students, and the MSc students and the MRes students.
And postdocs. And
and also postdocs, you know, and staff. And everybody gives talks there, right? So I've given a talk, Rebecca's given a talk. Ken, have you given a talk? You need to give a talk.
sometimes.
But it's, I mean, do you want to talk a bit about the PG research meetings, Ken? Because they're quite good to get your perspective.
Yeah, like, so like it's a weekly meeting, and basically it is a meeting that's attended by the research staff, the PhD students, MRes students, and the MSc creative computing students, and even the data science students as well. So it is kind of a weekly, I wouldn't actually call it that much of a lecture, because there's always kind of activities that we as a research group can kind of just explore together. So we have looked at different research methods. We have looked at the consequences of kind of certain research on certain communities. How will we deal with certain communities? How will we work with different kinds of communities to kind of further our research or design goals? And every single week, kind of the topics are all, I would say, very different from each other, because like it is more about whoever is presenting that week, they're presenting to us the methods, the approach that they take to their own practice. And I find that very helpful to kind of, in a way, I can pick and choose like things that are relevant to my own topics and just apply them appropriately.
That's brilliant. Just to say as well that we have students from the PhD and MPhil program across UAL also coming to those meetings. So sometimes we've had a meeting and there's been 30 people there, and there's quite a lot of people from outside CCI who've just rocked up to have a look. And, you know, yeah, it's quite fun. It's quite vibrant. I think it's been a lot of fun, that session.
Thanks, Mick. Thanks, Kenneth, as well, for sharing. Great. So we have another question, which says, what teaching and technical resources are available to CCI students?
Okay. So we have, at the moment, we have a facility on the fifth floor and also a space on the fourth floor of the new building at Camberwell, UAL Camberwell, the Camberwell campus. And that's a reasonably large space. So there is a physical computing lab, which is just in the process of being completed. It has 3D printers, soldering stations, everything you would need for building small robots, desktop robotic stuff. And if you wanted to build a system using Arduino or Raspberry Pi or similarly, there's a lab there for you. And there's also kitchen facilities, which are great for cooking and eating. There's also, what are we going to do without snacks, right? So yeah, the snacks are really important. There's also a computing lab. The computing lab has 25 machines in, I think, all with NVIDIA graphics cards, all running TensorFlow, and all capable of running, operating as computer graphics workstations as well. And they're actually accessible online. So you can use them just remotely from your home. You can just log in, pull up one of those workstations and access it and its GPU and run code in Python, or just, you know, do computer graphics and stream the desktop back to your system in your home. We also have a brand new M1 Apple laptops, a whole cupboard full of them. Like, I mean, I say cupboard, that doesn't really do it justice. It's like a massive, it's like a reasonably large room with those devices in, and they're networked and you can do the same thing. So you can log in to remote Apple devices and use them for building iPhone apps, doing machine learning, and they're all using the latest Apple M1. So yeah, we've got, yeah.
You forgot the VR gear and the sewing machines.
So that's right. So we've just taken delivery of a whole bunch of really large programmable, really awesome programmable sewing machines, which is so exciting. And yeah, and we just bought a whole load of VR kit that's just rocked up. I looked at it on Wednesday, looking at it, just wondering when I can take it home. Yeah, so you can do all kinds of stuff with that. There's a laser cutter as well, which is not installed yet, but it will be very soon. By the time you rock up, it will be there. It's a big, expensive beast. It's like 30 grand's worth of laser cutter. Yeah, so we've got quite a lot of gear. We've got a lot of gear.
I see Tom sending us reminders as we go. Knitting, embroidery, 3D printing, drawing machine, wood workshop.
I kind of wanted to get Tom to do this bit, but I didn't know whether I thought he might not be around, so I didn't want to kind of, but here he is, he's on the chat. Tom actually is in charge of all that stuff and knows much more about it than we do.
Thanks, Tom, for that. Yeah, amazing. Thanks so much for sharing that. And we have the last question here, which is, what is the CCI community like? Maybe each one of us can just like share, I don't know, a few words that describe what it's been like to be part of this community for all this long time we've been in there.
Inspiring, passionate, and hugely exciting.
I think we are diverse in many ways. I learn things all the time from my colleagues and from my students. I find it a really intellectually engaged, friendly, passionate community.
Yeah, I think like despite the kind of current circumstances with like COVID and everyone kind of basically working from home, learning from home, like the sense of community of CCI is kind of still around, and we have our own Slack channels, and it's one of the most active Slack channels that I've ever been on. And, well, I've been on a few. Yeah.
Amazing. Last
it's
one.
Not even just cat gifts either. It's you know, people sharing online events and sharing their work and getting technical feedback from folks outside, you know, the formal, you know, asking your instructors, but just a lot of really great community and peer support happening.
Completely. And I would say it's a very vibrant and playful community, because we always find our ways to have fun while we learn, and we just have fun. I think that's the most important thing there. And that really shows, you know, in the sort of work and the teaching experiences and, you know, the sort of spaces we create, that really makes a difference. So yes, thanks so much for sharing all of this. It's been an amazing chat. I think a very insightful one. Of course, this doesn't end here. So whatever question you have that maybe wasn't covered, we encourage you to contact us on our email, which is cci@artsacuk. So we'll be there to answer any other question that arises at any other point. Of course, we're on social media as well. You can find us on UAL_CCI, and there is where we share all the resources, all the new opportunities, events happening. So I would highly encourage you to follow us there to don't miss any opportunity. And talking about opportunity, something I also wanted to talk about before we leave today is an exciting learning program that we just launched that was designed by Dr. Pixcraft, who is the course leader of a new MA that we just launched this year at CCI, which is called MA in Internet Equalities. So this learning program will be literally open to everyone from any part of the world, any background. Anyone who's interested in technology and activism is welcome to take part in this learning program. The learning program is called, let me see if I can find the banner just to show you as I talk. There it is. So the program is called Technology and Power, Rights, Resistance, and Reimaginings. And we will be covering everything related to activism and technology. So the first part of the program will be a public seminar that will be running on the 6th and 7th of May from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. That is a public seminar open to everyone. And you can sign up on our Eventbrite. We're going to share the links afterwards on the chat. And the second part of the learning program is a workshop that will gather 25 people from across the world to just work on specific case studies that look at how to take agency in the technology field and do it in a creative way. We'll be working with contributors from around the world as well. It will be a very fun, engaging, and exciting opportunity to have a chat about how we can all be an activist in this area. And that's going to be happening, the workshop, on the first week of June. So that will be from the 1st to the 4th of June, from 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. each day. And yeah, there's an application process open at the moment, and we're going to be closing applications on the 11th of May, so there's still plenty of time to sign up. And yes, if that's something that you're really interested about, I would highly encourage you to apply. It's a very straightforward application process, and hopefully it's going to be a bunch of amazing people working together for a few days. So yes, I think that's all from me. I just wanted to say before we leave, thanks everyone for your contribution today. I really appreciate your time and your insight. And yeah, again, don't hesitate to contact us if you have any other questions about the MRes. And we hope that we can receive your application soon. Thanks, everyone. Have a lovely day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Bye-bye.